Well, blessings and greetings, friends, in the precious name of Jesus, and welcome back to Haya Kadosh Ministries, where holiness is a way of life, and Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And together God's people say, Hallelujah. Well, friends, we are continuing our study in the book of Galatians. Today we are going to be in chapter 4, beginning in verse 1, and it is important for us to remember the purpose of this letter to this young Christian fellowship that Paul is writing to. What we see taking place are a Gentile people that are very familiar with their pagan lifestyles, with their way of life, and they see something special about the Jewish people. And so somewhat nostalgic in their approach to this faith, they are attaching themselves to the things of the Jewish people, specifically the laws of the Jewish people. And what Paul is trying to communicate to them is that we are not to be as the Jewish people of old, but the Jewish people are to be as the Christians of new. And so we see that as difficult as it is for the Jewish people to take on this new way of life called Christianity, we see these Christians not satisfied with the liberty and grace that they now know and finding something attractive in the way that Jewish people live. And the reason that it's attractive is it offers us a way to be religious, to live within a system and order of beliefs that become a lifestyle. And because these young Christians know nothing of that lifestyle, they don't understand the bondage that lies therein. And yet you have these Jews who are so used to living under the rule and order of the law and forsaking to flee such laws, trying to take those who should be living under liberty and grace and bring them over to the law. That's what Paul is battling with here. So let's keep that in mind as we begin in Galatians chapter 4 and verse 1. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all. So what Paul is saying here is the heir, the one who is going to receive the promise of the inheritance, as long as he is a child, he is just like a servant in the household, even though he is the one promised to. The servant of the household isn't going to be heir to all the Father has promised. But the child will be, but he must come of age first. So as long as he is a child and awaiting that specific age to receive that inheritance, he is no different than the servant himself. Why? Because in verse 2, he is still under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. The same way that the servant lives under the rule of law in the father's household, so does the child. Now, both the child and the servant here represent life under the law. And so there was a time for these young Christians, as well as for us, where we lived under the law, where someone or something else was our taskmaster. And of course, we know that to be sin. And yet when we met Jesus Christ, we took on a new taskmaster. Jesus became our Lord, and sin and the things that represent sin no longer have control over us. So Paul continues in verse 3, and he says, so, understanding this, in the same way, when we were children, we were in bondage under the elements of the world. The elements of the world, we know because of chapter 4, verse 9 and 10, Paul says, now you have known God, or rather are known of God, how do you turn again to the weak and beggarly elements, whereunto you desired again to be in bondage? Because you observe days and months and times and years. So these elements represent the Jewish law. More specifically, the law of God. And so Paul is saying in verse 3, when we were children, before we came of age, before we became an heir to the promise that the Father had offered unto us through the person of Jesus Christ, We were in bondage under the rule of God. In verse 4, he says, when the fullness of the time was come, however, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. Now, what it means when it says Jesus was made of a woman, made under the law, he was born as a Jew, responsible to fulfill and carry out the law just like every other Jew was. But what made him different from every other Jew was that he could live it out with absolute and perfect obedience. No other Jew, no other man had ever done so. And by doing this, in verse 5, he redeems them that are under the law. He purchases them back. And so when he purchases them, they now belong to him. They no longer belong to the law. They no longer belong to the rule of law. And because of this, we receive the adoption of sons. We are no longer slaves and servants under the law. Now we become sons and heirs to everything that the Father has promised. We are no longer children, but now we are maturing and becoming adults in the spiritual kingdom. And in verse 6, because you are now sons and heirs, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. That's the inheritance. And friend, that is greater than any amount of gold that you could ever receive. To have the Spirit of the living God, the same Spirit that lived in Jesus when he walked this earth, now lives in you and I. Hallelujah. And out of all the things that we could ask the Father, that would be the greatest gift that he could bestow upon us. Verse 7, because you are no more a servant, and you can now say unto the Father, Father, not master, such as a slave would call his master, but you are his son, and he is your father, and you can say from your heart, Abba, Father. Because of this, you are no more a servant, but you are a son. And if a son, then you are an heir of God through Christ. Why? Because Christ is the Son of God. And everything that the Father has promised to bestow upon the Son, because you are now linked to the Son, you are now a part of the Son, Jesus Christ, you become a participant in the heir and the promise of all that God has offered unto him. And so he says in verse 8, howbeit then, when you did not know God, you did service unto them which by nature are no gods. Now you can think back in your life, you can think of the things that you served, the things that seemed to have control over you. You had no willpower in those areas of your life. They controlled you as your master. These were the things that we belonged to when we knew not God. We did service unto them, which are by nature no gods. But in verse 9, now, after that you have known God, or rather, God has known you, and that's important right there, friends. It's not the fact that you know God, it's the fact that God knows you. Do you remember what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21 through 23? They will stand before me on that day and say, Lord, look at all these things we've done in your name. And he will say, I never knew you. You may have known me, but I never knew you. It's like people saying, I found the Lord. No, you didn't. The Lord found you. The Lord found me, and praise his name for it. I was the one that was lost, not God. And so he says, after you have known God, or rather are known of God, how turn you again to these weak and beggarly elements wherein you desire again to be in bondage? Why do you seek to be like the Jews when God's ultimate purpose for the Jews is to come out of those weak and beggarly elements of life, to come out from under the bondage of the law, and to walk in the Spirit and grace and truth and liberty of his Spirit? He says you do this in verse 10 by wanting to observe days and months and times and years. You want to participate in the festivals of the Jewish people. You want to live life like them, but you're supposed to be attractive in your way of living that they want to leave where they're at and come over to where you're at. But you've got it reversed. You're trying to go back to what they were, and that tells them in their mind that you have nothing to offer. And more specifically, Jesus has nothing to offer. Because if you have now received Jesus, and yet you want to go back to the ways of old, then why are those that are bound in the ways of old going to want to come over and have anything to do with new life in Jesus Christ? I am afraid for you, lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain. All that I have done by coming to teach you the way of Jesus Christ, the time I have spent with you in seeking to help you discover this new life in Jesus seems to be in vain because you're not standing in the newness of spirit. You're wanting to go back to the ways of old. He continues in verse 12 and he says, "Brethren, I beseech you, be as I am, for I am as you are. You've not injured me at all." In other words, I was the most devout Jew that you could have ever met. I zealously followed the laws of old in a way that few ever know. And yet I have left those things behind, and I now stand in the liberty of Christ. And I want you to be as I am. Don't seek to go back. Stand firm where you are. Now, Paul says in verses 13 through 15, "When I first came unto you, I came in the infirmity of the flesh, and yet you received me as an angel of God. You were thrilled to hear the message that I brought to you. And because I told you what you both wanted and needed to hear, you received me with full acceptance." But in verse 16, he says, "But now I am become your enemy because I tell you the truth. Now you don't like what I'm telling you, so you turn against me. How fickle you are. Because those who bring this message of the law unto you, as zealous as they may be in what they're doing, they are corrupting the message of Jesus Christ." And so Paul is communicating here with a heart of tenderness his desire to see these young Christians grow and mature in their understanding and their fellowship with Jesus. And it brings him much pain to realize that they are being so easily misled. And that's what he says in the next few verses. "They zealously affect you, but not well. Yea, they would exclude you from this new faith in Christ, that you might affect them. But it is good to be zealously affected always in a good thing, not only when I am present with you. My little children, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you, I desire to be present with you now and to change my voice, for I stand in doubt of you." And so Paul is basically offering an apology. "I'm sorry to be so stern, but I'm concerned about what you're allowing to take place. So you being my spiritual children, I must take the role of a spiritual father. I must correct you in this." I mean, friends, we must admit there is something attractive about the Jewish people, their fortitude over time. Even in the fact that they have not accepted Messiah, their allegiance unto God, their commitment to their rituals and festivals, their commitment to prayer and fasting, the structured lifestyle that they have causes us to want to be envious in what they have in their dedication and service to God. But Paul is telling this young church, and he's telling us, they have nothing to offer us. They are empty, because they walk upon the face of this earth as mere men. But you, child of the living God, who now have converted and bowed your knee and surrendered to the lordship of Jesus Christ, you walk this earth as a man filled with the Spirit of God. And what you have is what every man wants, whether he realizes it or not. So walk in the Spirit and the vibrancy of the new relationship you have with the Son of God, and quit trying to be like those on the outside who may appear to be worthy vessels, yet on the inside, they're full of dead men's bones. That's the message, friends. And that's a message that we need to hear today just as much as they needed to hear it then. Because there is something about religion that draws us We find satisfaction in it. We find ease of conscience in it. We feel acceptance through it. But the only accomplishment that we have is in what Jesus did for us. Everything that we bring to the Father, every prayer, every action, every commitment, every service, are in His eyes as filthy rags. It's only through Jesus Christ that we find acceptance unto the Father. Well, friends, that's going to bring us to the end of our study today. I pray that you've been blessed. I pray that your eyes have been opened. I pray that you've been challenged. And I pray that your journey will be full of joy as you seek to walk with Jesus in every moment of your day. Now, as He wills, and until next time, friends, I love you. I'll see you on the next video.